So today, children, in the last video also we have started the chapters, that is the later Vedic period Aryavarta, that is chapter 6, that is in page number 51 of your history book. Okay, so we have completed the first page, that is Aryavarta, later Vedic period. Today we will start with the political structure of this. Okay, let us go line wise. While in the early Vedic period, kings ruled over small tribes or clans, in the later Vedic period, these tribes expanded to form large kingdoms. The earliest Aryan kingdom were Kuru, Panchala, Kosala, Magad, and Kashi. These were the earliest Aryan kingdoms. Okay. And while in the early Vedic period, kings ruled over small tribes or clans, that small groups. In the later Vedic period, these tribes, they were expanded. They did not remain small. They were expanded to large kingdoms. They did not remain small till then, and now they were in expansion. They now became in expanded large kingdoms. Okay, and these were large kingdoms. Were the earliest Aryan kingdoms were Kuru, Panchala, Kosala, Magad, and Kashi. Clear? Now, next paragraph, what it is written? The formation of larger kingdoms increased the power of chief or king. Yes, as the expansion will be. Okay, so as will be now the. So as will be now the what to say? The formation of larger kingdom. Of course, the kingdoms will also become now larger. Okay, and the power of king or the chief will also be increased. Kingship became hereditary. Now, tribal assemblies like this Sabha and Samiti lost their importance. They lost their importance. Sabha and Samiti, which were in tribes, which were in small groups. The king's influence was stressed by rituals. And the king's influence, the king was now being worshipped by the people. He performed the Rajasuya sacrifice, which was supposed to confer supreme power of him. The Ashwamedha or the horse sacrifice, okay, now it has been started, was also performed to establish the king's undisputed authority over the areas the horse moved unchallenged. Now, next to that comes the social life of this, under which comes first the class structure. The occupation division of society of early Vedic period became more rigid and hereditary in the later Vedic period. Now, the occupational division of the society, it became more rigid and hereditary. Social classes were now known as caste or varna. They were no, now known as caste or varna. They have been divided. You know, we have already studied in the previous chapters, decided by birth and not by occupation. They have been now classified according to their birth, not according to the occupation what they have. And the main varnas were four. Which are those? The four main varnas were the Brahmins or the priestly class, which already was discussed in the previous chapter. Kshatriyas or the ruling and warrior class. This also was explained. Vaishyas or the traders. Under the Vaishyas comes the traders, merchants, peasants, and artisans was also discussed. And the Shudras, or the lowest class engaged in menial work, that is maybe cleaning of different things. Okay. The caste system became so rigid that people were not allowed to change their caste or occupation. Brahmins and Kshatriyas enjoyed privileges, that is a very good position in societies, denied to Vaishyas and Shudras. These Brahmins and Kshatriyas, as Brahmins were the priestly class, they were also being called in different occupations like marriages and different family functions. Kshatriyas, though they were like ruling and warrior class, so they were also being given a very good prestige in this society. In comparison to Vaishyas, those who were traders, merchants, peasants and artisans, people thought that this work is not good or this work was a small work. And the Vaishyas and the Shudras also, as they used to do the menial works. Okay. Intercaste marriages were strictly prohibited as the high caste people looked down upon the low caste people. That time intercaste was also not given good, or they were not preferred by the people at that very time. Now, after that, coming towards the four ashrams, were towards a later Vedic period, the life of individual was divided into four stages or ashrams. And what were these four stages? Each stages indicated the journey of man according to Vedic tradition. Let's see. Brahmacharya ashram or a student life was the first stage of man's life. Yes, we all know at that very time it started, and the student's life was considered to be the man's first life. Okay, in this stage he receives education from his guru or teacher in a gurukul. Earlier children, there were no schools, there were no colleges, and the students, whatever they have to gain knowledge, whatever knowledge they used to gain, they used to gain it from the gurus who they were the disciples of, and these students were known as the disciples of these gurus, and they were given a proper education, they were given a proper knowledge in the gurukuls. Okay, then is Grihastha Ashram. Grihastha Ashram, or life as a householder, is the stage where the man gets married and performs his duty as a son, husband and father. That is, we used to say in the other word, Grihastha Jindagi. Okay, that is a man when he enters in the life, when he gets the when he is married, then after the marriage his life starts. Then he becomes a father, then first he was only a son, then a husband, then a father, and so on. That very time used to known as Grihastha Ashram. During this stage, he works to earn a living for his family using the skills he learned in Gurukul. Okay? Then, next is Vanaprastha Ashram. What is Vanaprastha? Van, you see now, or the life as a hermit, is a stage when the man, after completing his worldly duties, duties what he has performed in the ashram, duties what he has already performed in the grihastha, after that, after completing his worldly duties, hands the household responsibility to a successor. Successor, that is, maybe the successor is a purse and leaves the worldly life. That is, he gives all his responsibilities to his successor, or you can say to his son, or if he has if he has no son, so he at that way condition he gives the responsibility to a person whom he has adopted as a son, a child whom he has adopted as a son. Okay. And lives the worldly life, and then he lays all his responsibilities and gives his responsibilities to the person. He goes to the forest and then he leaves everything. He leaves everything. No, no love for the family, no love for the child, no love for the money, nothing. Okay, he goes to the forest and leads a life of meditation and solitude, like a sadhu, you can say. Okay, sant. Then is sannyas ashram. And the fourth ashram is sannyas ashram, or a life as a sadhu. Just as I said just now, he lives in a forest and his life is under meditation and solitude. So he lives as a sadhu. Is a last stage where the man renounces all the comforts, wipes away all the comforts of life. Becomes spiritual, that is, he is totally now his mind is totally now given towards the prayers. Okay, becomes spiritual, leads a life of an ascetic, focusing on moksha. Now he only wants moksha for the words he has done. He only wants moksha for his life, from his life. And children, I hope so these four ashrams and the social life you have understood, and the political life. Now children, in the next video we will start with this Gurukul system of education. Hope so you all have understood whatever I have taught you. Next, children, if your question answers are not coming on dashboard, it is not visible on the dashboard, please listen to it carefully, children. If your question answers are not visible on dashboard after completion of this chapter, when I complete this chapter, after that I will give you question answers in oral in the video itself. Okay, I will be dictating you question wise, and you will be writing in your rough copy. Kindly, you write in your rough copy, and then after that you write in your fair copy. Okay, so as you can you should not miss any question answers, and you will be writing everything. Okay, thank you.